cable subscribers on the C-SPAN audio networks. C-SPAN is brought to you as a public service of your local cable television company. Coming next, a Democratic candidates debate sponsored by the U.S. Conference of Mayors. On March 31st, Democratic frontrunner Governor Bill Clinton and Jerry Brown squared off at Gracie Mansion in New York, the home of Mayor David Dinkins. Chief executives from a number of New York State cities, along with neighboring New Jersey and Connecticut, questioned the two candidates about urban policy. Voters in the Empire State go to the polls next Tuesday.
Okay.
This is pretty, it's like a cockfight.
Can you make you to move over?
Get around the pit and watch them
okay.
Chew each other.
All right. Okay. I will not ask, as I usually do, is anybody not ready? Because I know that everybody's ready now. Good afternoon. And I welcome our two distinguished presidential candidates, former Governor Jerry Brown and Governor Bill Clinton, and the mayors from around the country who have come to New York today for this most important occasion. A discussion with our two leading Democratic presidential contenders about the dire plight of American cities. To paraphrase President John F. Kennedy, I believe this is the most extraordinary collection of talent that has ever been gathered at Gracie Mansion, with the possible exception of when Fiorello LaGuardia dined here alone. Seriously, my friends, we are here this afternoon because our cities face some very serious problems. 12 years of Republican policies in the White House have wreaked havoc in our house and in houses across our land. As mayors confronting this very difficult time, we realize that a turnaround in the national economy will happen only when Washington commits itself to better lives for our people, not to better bombs for our armies and bigger tax breaks for the privileged. Indeed, as we work to fill gaps of billions of dollars where there once was federal aid, we sometimes feel, quite frankly, as if Washington has placed a giant boulder in the paths of all state and local officials, directing us to roll it up the steepest of hills. We are the casualties of a war of neglect. But the victims of this war are not American cities alone. No, they include every citizen of the United States who needs the goods manufactured in cities. The idea is born from our cities, great universities and research centers, the public transportation networks that provide affordable travel for all. Indeed, our nation can only prosper in the 21st century if New York, Los Angeles, Cincinnati, Boston, and Newark prosper and regain their historic roles as intellectual, cultural, and commercial centers. In New York City today, more than half of our residents are middle class. The average earning of our workers is about $35,000, and New York has had a long, progressive, never-to-be-abandoned tradition of helping our poorer residents. But we can no longer deal with the serious problems that afflict this entire nation without the dollars taken from us by Washington in the last decade. Can any rational person be so short-sighted as to not comprehend that this abandonment of our cities is destroying our country? Well, far be it from me to call our current leaders irrational, but let me give you some facts and figures about our plight. These were Washington's choices. At the beginning of the Reagan administration, the federal government spent only $7 on defense for every dollar it spent on housing. Now that ratio has skyrocketed to $46 spent on defense for every dollar spent on housing. While 25% of American tax dollars go to our national defense, a measly 1% is used for reinvestment in cities and towns. In New York City, if the federal government had maintained the level of aid it gave us 10 years ago, our operating budget would have received an additional $1.2 billion this year. In addition to that, over $2.5 billion in housing money would have enriched our capital construction program. These callous decisions affecting our cities occurred during a decade in which the federal government expanded its budget by 29%, with most of the money going toward defense spending. New York's plight is Milwaukee's plight. The man who has lost his job in Chicago is no different from the newly unemployed worker in Seattle. Our sizes may vary, but our challenges are the same. We need affordable housing and decent health care. We need real job training programs. We need additional resources to treat our residents suffering from AIDS. We need effective gun control legislation to protect the lives of our children dying from gunfire that sounds throughout our land. Our challenges are many, but a concerted partnership with the federal government can help restore our cities to their historic role as world leaders in commerce and culture. So just before we get started with our specific questions, I want to ask the mayors coming from my right to introduce them. Give your name and your city, please.
Mayor Joseph Gannon, Bridgeport, Connecticut.
Mayor Tom Young, Syracuse, New York.
Mayor Dave Karp, San Leandro, California.
Mayor Dwight Hillary, Cincinnati.
Mayor Carrie Saxon, Perry Hartford, Connecticut.
Well, we all know Ray Boston of Ray Flynn of Boston.
The name is synonymous. From the city.
Mayor Doug Palmer from Mayor Dinkins' hometown, Trenton, New Jersey.
Sharp James, Newark, New Jersey.
Sean Hogan, City of Hornell, New York.
Tom Whalen, Albany, New York.
Cardell Cooper, East Orange, New Jersey.
Okay. So we'll get started now with specific questions for our candidates. Our format is tight, and therefore I ask everyone to adhere to our time limits, as difficult as that may be. The mayors have a minute to ask a question. Candidates each have 1 minute to respond. They will then be allowed a 30-second rebuttal, and finally, each has 2 minutes for a closing statement. Now, and before we commence, we have a statement from my esteemed colleague, the distinguished president of the U.S. Conference of Mayors, Mayor of Boston, Ray Flynn.
Thank you, Mayor Dinkins, and let me thank you for hosting this reception, bringing everybody together. Let me thank my colleagues from cities who are on the front lines of the war in saving our cities and the war to save our children. My comments will be nothing in terms of prepared response comments, but I do want to give one observation that I do hope we're able to achieve following today's discussion with these two distinguished Democrats. Last Saturday night, I was in Charlestown, Massachusetts, part of my district in Boston. For those people who don't know, Charlestown is the place where Jack Kennedy was a member of the Knights of Columbus when he first ran for Congress. And I told my constituents that I was coming to New York City to meet with Governor Clinton and Governor Brown. And what is it that you would ask me, you would want me as your representative, as somebody who works for you, what would you want me to tell them? What would you want me to ask them? They said, Ray, one guy said to me, look, my kid graduated from BU. He can't find a job. Another guy said to me, and his wife said to me, I can't afford to send my kid to college anymore. The costs are just staggering. This is one period of time of my life that I really feel frustrated. I don't believe anybody is on my side. Stay with me. Nobody is on my side. Last night, I went down to the Eagle Tavern to listen to a little bit of Irish music and to watch the NIT. Obviously, you know who the people were cheering for down at the Eagle Tavern. If I was listening to Irish music, it was Notre Dame playing Utah. They were cheering for Notre Dame. And as I was sitting next to a couple of people there listening to the music, I said, I'm going to be meeting with the candidates for president tomorrow. What are the issues here in New York City? They said the issues are jobs, the economy, getting people back to work, and what's the future of our kids? Now, later on that night, I went jogging. Late last night, I went jogging. Ran by the Eagle Tavern area again, right around the corner, Governor, is Covenant House. 4 or 5 kids standing outside of the Covenant House who are runaway kids. And they said, what's the future? Where are we going? What's in it for us? The three messages that I heard in Charlestown, Yesterday, last night, and in the Covenant House, were who's on my side? Who's going to fight for me? So I think that's what we're here today for in New York. This is our first opportunity. It may be our only opportunity to make sure that finally we get a candidate who can beat an administration in Washington that is not on their side. We need somebody who's going to be on our side. And let us begin from here. This is the first day of the campaign, getting people back to work, fighting for our cities, fighting for our kids. The Democratic Party is on our side. These candidates are on our side. That's how we're going to win the White House in November. Only that way. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have this first question, and by prearrangement with their respective staffs, this question will go to Governor Brown first, and then Governor Clinton will have an opportunity to answer, and they each will have then 30 seconds if they wish a rebuttal. Tomorrow, Wednesday, April 1st, the House Government Operations Committee is scheduled to mark up H.R. 3601, the Local Partnership Act, introduced by Chairman John Conyers. This bill would restore targeted fiscal assistance to local governments. It would provide $15 billion in funding this year, $5 billion in fiscal year 1994, $8 billion in fiscal year 1995, $11 billion in 1996, and $14 billion in 1997. These funds could be spent on education, public safety, health, social services such as emergency food and shelter, and environmental services. The funds are to be used to rehire, restore services, or expand programs that are overburdened due to the impact of the recession. Senator Sasser has a similar bill, S-2299, in the Senate. President Bush has not endorsed restoration of targeted fiscal assistance. Do you support this program, Governor Brown?
Yes, I do support it. I support it for a very simple reason. The priorities of this country are out of whack. Too much has been spent on star wars and not star cities. The engine of civilization is in urban America and its connection to suburban America. As one dies, so does the other. We found the $291 billion last year for the military. We can find a fraction of that for the revitalization of our cities. And that act, targeting with maximum flexibility to the mayors and those locally responsible, is precisely the kind of shift in priorities that this country needs.
Governor Clinton.
In the urban policy that I issued several weeks ago, with the help of many mayors who helped me put it together, I advocated just such targeted urban investment strategies. In terms of the specific dollar values, I'd like to see Senator Sasser's bill to know exactly how it's being worked into the budget, but it's exactly what I think we ought to do. I think we ought to have categories of funds where the cities make a decision about how to spend the money within specific categories, all of which would increase the total investment budget of the United States to make us wealthier. One point I'd like to make in my 30-second rejoinder here is that, and I think Governor Brown and I agree on this, we are here debating urban issues, but urban America's problems are America's problems. They're America's problems not only because the fate of the cities determines in some measure the fate of the nation as a whole, but also because those problems can be found even if in smaller volumes in the smaller towns, the suburbs, in the rural areas of this country. So I think that we're here to discuss the neglect of this administration and its predecessor for a decade. That's an American problem, not just a city's problem, and the American people ought to see these issues as all of their problems.
30 seconds, Governor Brown, if you wish to.
I think the big question in all this is, how come it's not happening? How come in the last couple of days Congress was voting a $25 billion for the failed SNL debacle, and at the same time there aren't dozens of people standing up on the floor of the Congress saying, wait a minute, we're not going to put another penny into that rat hole until we invest in our people in the dying cities of this country? And that's the real question. What does it take to shift the priorities from those things that are on the front burner, Star Wars, the hangover from the Cold War, and bailing out the mistakes and corruption of the SNL mess, and put it to the future, to the Renaissance, to the kids, to the futures. That's why I say we the people can, because when we take back our power, we're going to make precisely that shift happen.
The next question goes first to Governor Clinton and is presented by Mayor Carey Perry of Hartford.
All right, my question has two parts, and it addresses the basic economic problems that's facing this country. We have a concern in the city of Hartford, and we're presented with a decision about gambling and a casino opening, because the casino is offering 16,000 jobs. And they say to me, Mayor, if you're against this casino coming, are you going to be able to provide these kinds of jobs for your people? And I don't have an answer for it right now, so my question addresses that directly. Would you support efforts in Congress this year, before you are president, to stimulate the economy, even if that means increasing the deficit? Specifically, would you support direct, no strings, immediate grants to local governments? And my second part is, after you are elected president, what will you do to assure the long-term economic health of the nation? And it's to Governor Clinton first.
Well, first of all, I would support targeted urban development grants with flexibility for the cities, like the Conyers and the Sasser approach. So the only string would be you'd have to spend the money in an area that would, whichever area you chose, you'd be increasing aggregate investment to generate more wealth and more opportunity in the cities. I would support that. So there would be some strings, but only by category. Within that, it would be up to the cities to decide. I think we need a long-term economic strategy for this country. Basically, we're in the grip of economic decline and social disintegration, and we're saddled with a political system that believes the only job of politics is to keep taxes low and to get out of the way. I believe we need to vote in this election for a dramatically different approach than either party provided in the 1980s, one that will increase investment and opportunity, challenge the American people to assume the responsibilities of the kind of society we'll have to create in the post-Cold War era. Let me just give you one example directly targeted toward urban areas, if I might. Most people who moved to the cities in search of jobs came there for manufacturing jobs. The manufacturing base of the cities has been eroding for years and years. Most new jobs are now created in the small business economy. But no one thought to create the structures that would create jobs in the small business sector for the people who've been abandoned. That's why I have called for a national network of community development banks modeled on the South Shore Bank in Chicago for every urban area of any size in this country, along with small business incubators and the other support services to create jobs like that. I don't want you or any other mayor to have to make the decision to go for gambling or no jobs at all. And that is, I'll have 30 more seconds at the end, but that's basically what I would do.
Well, I might, what we'll have to do is Herbie Block sitting behind me has a timer that doesn't sound off very loud, so what we will do henceforth is when the minute has expired, Herbie, you will tell me so that I can advise the governors, and then they will then reserve their 30 seconds for later instead of using it in one lump. Governor Brown.
Yes, I would support grants to local government for their spending to revitalize the cities, and I would do so in the context of an educational program to clearly communicate the truth that the so-called efficiencies of business exporting jobs abroad, leaving the cities, has piled up huge costs in crime, in broken families, in destroyed lives of children, and that this kind of spending and investment is not just another consumption, but it is an investment program to make all of America richer and more prosperous. And it's that notion that has totally escaped the planners and the people in the Bush and Reagan administrations.
You get 30 seconds.
I would just like to point out one other thing that I think that is very important. We must have a national system of affordable health care for all that controls cost and brings health care costs within inflation. If we were to do that, instead of just sending out more health mandates to the states and cities every year, that would also free up an awful lot of money in our cities for investment purposes, for generating jobs and improving the quality of life. So another reason to elect a Democrat is to get affordable health care for all Americans and put a lid on these health care costs and stop the mandates.
You have you had yours?
Well, I'll just say that that you have a real health care program, you need a single-payer system that will truly take the load off the cities and promote the kind of preventative health as well as take care of those in need, seeing health care as a right of every citizen, not as a commodity to be played with for profit.
The next question goes to Governor Brown from Mayor Douglas Palmer of Trenton, New Jersey.
Thank you. I'm glad to hear both candidates discussing that cities are the engine of the economy. A few weeks ago, Judgment Nuremberg was on about war crimes, and I was thinking that if a foreign power were in charge of the cities over the last decade, the last 10 years, based on the deterioration of the cities and the deterioration of families and lives, that government would be charged with war crimes and be prosecuted. That's the state that we're in. I believe that we need to bring economic opportunity to communities, and it requires more than just business incentives. It really requires a strong public investment and public commitment. It requires an educated and trained workforce, an effective health care system, good roads, good housing, good water and sewer systems, and public safety. And I think it's very important that you recognize, as whoever's president, that the cities need help, but we're not helpless. And if given the opportunities and the resources, that we can be the cities that we once were. My question to you first, Governor Brown, is what would you do to comprehensively address the need to invest more in this nation's cities?
At first, I get myself elected on a platform that says precisely this and operates as the battering ram to break down that citadel of blindness and complacency that continues year after year to go along with the kind of almost genocide of a whole generation of youth. And it is true. It is we can't call it a war crime because politically that will get us all in trouble. But the fact is, if it was an occupying power, you'd have a very good case on your hands. And I believe that until people can hear it, see it, and smell it, the devastation and degradation that millions of Americans are facing every day of their lives, they're not going to get it. And I think if they do, Americans are a generous and a wise people. What is required is the same level of commitment that Reagan could have for a Star Wars, but only this time it's for star cities, or for star schools, or for star human beings. We have the money. We've shown that when we're prepared to go to war in the Gulf, when we're prepared to bail out the SNLs and whatever. The problem is the insight is not penetrating the folks in Washington, and that's what we have to mobilize the moral force to overcome.
Governor Clinton.
I would increase investment, but I would do it in a way that would maximize local initiative and reward things that are working, efforts that are being made to change the very fabric of life at the grassroots level. I've already given you one example, the community development banks, new tax incentives to invest in our cities. I would support full funding of Head Start, smaller classes in the early grades, elementary counselors, access to apprenticeships for people who don't want to go to college, access to a college education through National Service Trust, more clinics, healthcare clinics in inner city neighborhoods, an environmental strategy for water, sewer, wastewater, and a whole strategy on crime and drugs. But I would reward those things which work, innovations such as those that I've seen in the cities of many people around this table, and I'll talk about that in my rebuttal time.
I would differ somewhat with Governor Clinton on that in this sense, that to truly empower mayors, local school boards, we have to give them flexibility. And when you tick off all the different programs, you're now imposing a series of categorical restraints on the spending, which generates the bureaucracy and the cross pressures on local government to account for how they're spending it. I'd much prefer to see a less detailed shifting of funds to local communities so they may invest in the kind of revitalization that they see on the front lines where they live every day.
The next question goes I'm sorry. Forgive me.
Well, I think within investment categories, mayors should have great flexibility. I think I have called repeatedly for less restrictions on state and local government. Man, I've been a governor. I know about all these mandates. You're not going to have a lot of mandates from my administration, but you will have a focus on investment strategies that work. And I also want to emphasize that there is a limit to what the national government can do in the absence of real innovation at the local level. Programs like the City Year program in Boston or the housing projects I've seen in Mayor Young's city or any number of other examples I could cite. So I do believe that we should give more flexibility to the mayors, but it should be within categories designed to produce given results, because we've got to increase our competitive position and our ability to generate opportunity.
The next question comes from Mayor David Karp of San Leandro, California, and it goes first to Governor Brown.
Thank you very much. As you probably know, we've had a number of base closures, and we have many more on the list. In addition to the unemployed and those work closures creating problems within the cities, we also have a problem with what our president now has, which has proposed free trade with our good friends from Mexico and Canada. And what is happening is, in our particular area, in California and in other states, businesses are closing up. They're moving down to an area where there's no environmental constraints. Wages are by far less. Working conditions, you don't have the high quality working conditions. And we're moving to the point now where it is going to be coming up before Congress. My question to you is, what trade policies are needed to create a fair trading relationship with our competitors?
First of all, I oppose the fast track of jobs to Mexico because it is taking place with too much authority for the president and in the total absence of an economic strategy of economic conversion from the huge Cold War spending program. The military budget must be cut. I propose 50% over 5 years, and as it's cut, there must be a strategy of investment in infrastructure and high-speed trains, the new energy technologies, in a civilian conservation corps, and all the other characteristics of a civilized society. We can create an expanding trading regime in the world, but we can't do so by destroying the heart, not only of our cities, but the areas all across this country, as I've encountered during this campaign. I mean, people are angry. They are demanding that our leadership in Washington look to protect their jobs. That's the first requisite of the American president and the American Congress. And we can expand trade, but we have to do it only in the context of a strategy that will commit and realize a high-wage, high-productivity economy.
I think you've made a case, Mayor, for the right kind of trade agreement with Mexico. It's in our interest to expand trade and reduce the deficit with Mexico under terms which would require them to invest more money in raising labor standards and in cleaning up their environment so that both countries can grow richer. If we have no agreement, jobs will continue to be on a fast track to Mexico just because there are no wage standards and there are no environmental standards. So I would favor a trade agreement. Every serious academic study of reducing the defense budget shows we can create more jobs if we have a disciplined 5-year conversion plan. I would spend about half the money on infrastructure, about half the money on the emerging technologies of the future. We need an economic strategy to make us a high-wage, high-growth country. Research and development, the equivalent of Japan, a system for getting companies into export, the equivalent of Germany, a labor training policy, the equivalent of Sweden. There are all these countries that are doing things better than we are. All we have to do is make American models of what works, and we can have high-growth, high-wage economy in America, but we got to pay for it.
One of the things that always gets looked over, and that is the structural changes. I'm not talking about what we can stimulate in Mexico by way of wage increases. I want to find out what we can do here, because this is what we have some control over. That's why I strongly support trade union labor law reform, the repeal of 14B, and a expansion dramatically in employee ownership. If the people who work in a factory or a business have a stake in the ownership, you're going to see modernization, and you're going to see protecting the enterprise base right here, and not this movement offshore to maximize profit at the expense of American communities and American citizens.
What we can do here is to change the tax code to give more incentives to invest in this country and remove those incentives to move overseas. What we can do here is to figure out what works. Take the request of the American Computer Company executives for a strategy to get more jobs in computers in the 21st century. All we have to do is to develop a strategy in each of these critical areas and execute it, and we can create more high-wage jobs.
Okay. The next question goes first to Governor Clinton. It comes from Mayor Sharp James of Newark.
I think the Governor, the Kerner Commission conclusions are alive and well. We're being divided between black and white, suburban and urban, rich and poor, bias crimes. And the question comes, you know, what do we do about it? But I looked at some of the proposals being offered by both of you. My question will come, former Defense Secretary Robert McNamara said he could cut the defense budget by 50% if you two were president. What would you actually cut it? And then how do we diffuse these terrible consequences that people want to know? People are just not comfortable in today's environment. We need leadership to end these consequences. And of course, my question to you is this, like, you got to pay for all these things. You're not going to say no new taxes, read my lips. So if we cut the budget, what can the military budget be cut? And how do you diffuse these consequences that we face in today's society?
Well, part of the way you diffuse it is by reducing military spending by, I think, at least 36% over the next 5 years through the end of my first term, including this year, and these cuts. They can be cut more if you can reduce the nuclear arsenal in the former Soviet Union. You can even do more, I think. That money should be reinvested in our country to create a sense of hope and purpose and mission. But beyond that, frankly, the president has got to challenge the American people to come back together across racial and ethnic lines, to make the most of their diversity instead of use it as a way of keeping us all down. And we've got to take violence in the streets, in the cities, and especially against our young people head on. This is not simply a money problem. There are cultural issues at stake here that require us all, city by city, neighborhood by neighborhood, to challenge the American people to change. But first, the leaders have to change the national priorities and give genuine hope so that people think if they play by the rules and work hard, they will be rewarded.
Well, the way to do it is we can't keep carrying on with the mythology that something like the Seawolf in Connecticut that Governor Clinton supported is going to be needed in a post-Cold War era. We have to come up with the program such as a B-2 bullet train, a high-speed rail instead of B-2 bombers. We have to make the transformation. The level of funding is there, it's just in the wrong place, and we have to put it right where we need it. You have as many empty buildings in Harlem as you did in 1976. When Jimmy Carter went up there. And the reason is that people have moved out and those who are there don't have the income to support the kind of rent that would be required to fix those buildings up. And that means jobs. And we haven't made them because those people don't have power and they're not being heard. And the principal task is not only to articulate the list of what we should do, but it's to mobilize the moral force to dedicate ourselves to the unmet agenda that was knocked out of this country 25 years ago.
I favor an investment in high-speed rail, too. Also investments in new water and wastewater and sewer systems for the cities and any number of other job-generating opportunities. I favor cuts in the defense budget, in carrier groups and troops in Europe, in Star Wars and any number of other areas. I would point out that a majority of the Democratic defense experts in the Congress believe we need a smaller, lighter submarine, and the most cost-effective way to do that is to finish the second Seawolf and move into the Centurion, the smaller submarine. If you're going to have fewer troops, they have to be more mobile on land, on air, and sea, and I think that all of us would want the right kind of defense for our nation.
The next question comes from Mayor Dwight Tillery of Cincinnati, and it goes first to Governor Brown.
Governor Brown, as states try to balance their budget during this recession, many states are passing on cuts and restrictions to the AFDC programs. Senator Moynihan has stated that $6 billion is needed to fully fund the welfare reform program. Would you provide full funding for these programs?
Well, sure. What it takes to invest in our human beings and our human family, we have to do. I've suggested some changes, turning the welfare check, making it available as a welfare voucher to be turned into a private sector job and then have that welfare check added to by the employer and then slowly reduce it over a five-year period. I've also suggested enterprise zones that everybody's been talking about for 10 years, but no one has been willing to commit the funds in the areas of greatest unemployment and public assistance for the tax incentives that would be required to get business to go out there. But if we're going to be serious about getting people on welfare, the training, the child care, and the work opportunity, it's going to take a major shift in priorities. And in that context, I think the level of spending you mentioned is quite reasonable.
I helped Senator Moynihan and Congressman Downey to write the Welfare Reform Act of 1988. I believe in it very strongly. I know it will work. In our state, the caseloads have grown by less than one-third the national average because we have tried to aggressively implement the program. We do need a considerably increased amount of money to do two things. One, to invest more in education and training, child care, and medical coverage for the children. And secondly, to provide transportation and other services to those who are moving into the workplace. And yes, I would be in favor of funding the program because I know it works. You can require people to go to work, and they will go to work if you provide support for children and you invest in empowering them to have the capacity to work. So I believe very, very strongly in the bill, and I want to see it fully funded today. We're getting the worst of all worlds. The successful states are punished with cutbacks if they do succeed in putting people to work.
If you wish.
The only thing I'd say is that as we see this unanimity and consensus building, one has to raise the question, well, if it's so clear, how come our Democratic colleagues in Congress aren't at least putting the bill on the president's desk? And again, I'd have to point to the decrepit state of the politics as usual down there. They need a good push, and that push is going to have to come from a grassroots take back of what we've lost in this country, and that is a politics committed to social and economic justice. Something has to happen that hasn't happened for 20 years. And that is really the step that is missing, because we know the list. What we now have to do is to make sure that list has any chance of getting passed.
That's what you have elections for. The people are in the driver's seat at election time. That's why it's so important that we be as specific and clear as possible so we lay down an agenda that galvanizes the energies of people who do want to reform in the Congress. It sends a clear signal from the American people. That is why the specificity of our economic and our urban plans is so terribly important.
The next question is from Sean Hogan of Hornell, New York, and it goes first to Governor Clinton.
Governor Clinton, there's been much discussion on the issue of tax fairness in this campaign year. It's clear that the federal tax code has become very unfair to working people and their families. You favor retaining a progressive income tax. Would you support a refundable credit for those families that make too little to benefit from other income tax reforms?
Absolutely. I have been on the front lines of supporting the earned income tax credit for more than 2 years now. And I think the thing that most Americans don't know and might be surprised by is that most poor people in this country work for a living. Most of them are out there working, doing the very best they can. And I think if you're putting in 40 hours a week, you got kids in the house, there ought to be a refundable earned income tax credit that lifts you above the poverty line, gives you a living wage that you can invest in your children and your quality of life. We have to reward work, and that's a way to make this system far more progressive.
Thank you. Governor Brown.
Yeah, I think that the people at the lower end need targeted assistance, and that's an earned income tax credit's one way to do it. The dirty little secret is that the people at the bottom who are struggling the most with their low wages are paying principally payroll taxes. That's their big tax bite, not the personal income tax. And for that, there's no deduction whatsoever. And in my tax proposal that will cut the taxes on Americans, we will provide a rental deduction. And that will turn out to be a very progressive tax, with those, the bottom 20% paying about 6% and the top paying closer to 13%. Everybody gains, including the economy is stimulated.
Well, obviously, I disagree with Governor Brown's proposal. If you take the 13% income tax plus the 13% value-added tax, Every objective analyst who's looked at it says it will increase taxes on the poor and the middle class, give me a tax reduction, and give people who are in the top 1% a huge tax break. And I think it will be very damaging to many of our cities because it repeals the deductibility of state and local income taxes from the federal tax code. It will add $180 billion to the national deficit. It will, by ending the payroll tax contributions, end the separate treatment of Social Security retirement. So I think it is a very bad idea, and so does every other person who doesn't have a stake in the campaign one way or the other who's analyzed it. I think if you put the value-added tax and the flat tax together, you get a lot more regression in the tax code, and you aggravate the problem of the middle class and the lower middle class poor.
Yeah, the big thing everybody misses is this economy is stuck in the water, and there aren't any new jobs because the tax code is like a wet blanket, a ball and a chain on this economy. And the key is to make business pay their fair tax without being able to buy out with all the loopholes. And there aren't all these objective experts. There's one who formerly was part of this Wilhelm fellow, his campaign manager. So the experts that I've looked at tell me that when you tax business, you're taxing capital. And most capital is owned by the richest people. That's the key. And we are going to provide a program that's not only progressive, but it's going to create the kind of jobs that all around this table we've been desperately seeking, but no one has yet been able to provide them.
A value-added tax is not a tax on business. It's a tax that business passes on to consumers. The argument you just heard is the same argument we've heard for the last decade. Lower taxes on upper-income people and companies. Pass the tax along. Everything will be all right. We've tried that. It's another one of those simple-sounding ideas that makes things worse. It will redistribute wealth upward. It will undermine growth. It will undermine fairness. Look at the rich countries. You have fairness and growth in Germany, in Japan, in the other countries in Northern Europe, and that's what we need for this country.
Very simply, I respond to that by saying the way that when you put a tax on business, you're putting a tax on that business, and that's the same argument against the corporate tax, against medical benefits, and against all the things that liberal people want to put on business, and conservatives always fight.
I was about to commend each of you the role of moderator over to my distinguished colleague from Boston. I know how difficult it is, and I think you both have been very well. I hope that you will give the same cooperation to Mayor Flynn of Boston. You're on, sir.
Thank you, Mayor Dinkins. I want to say that nobody really expects any one of you gentlemen, the President or the Congress, to solve all the problems of America's cities. We understand that there are some very serious financial problems in Washington, D.C. Certainly the deficit is crippling and burdening our children and our grandchildren. It's something that we want to deal with. I guess the question is, again, getting back to my original point, we want somebody who's going to listen to us, who's going to be on our side when we have concerns and problems. There are things, however, that can be done. One, certainly the issue of firearms. We have 200 million firearms in America today. There are only 250 million people. We're the most violent, we're the most armed country in America. There's a bill in Washington right now, it's called the Brady Bill. It asks for a 5-day notice period before a person can buy guns. Will you support that proposal? And secondly, an extension of something else that you can do that doesn't cost a lot of money, and that is the issue of homelessness. Homelessness is a crisis in this country brought about because of a callous policy on the part of the federal government. They stopped getting into the business of providing affordable housing. We're not talking about solving all the problems for our cities, but will you be a partner so that we can deal with the issue of homelessness, we can get people out of our parks and playgrounds and our benches? And I disagree, and I want to know where you people stand on the issue. Do you think homelessness is a problem that can't be solved like Jack Kemp and the President think, or do you think that it's a problem that can be solved, the presidents and the mayors and the various church organizations working together? That question is directed at first to Mr. Brown.
Yeah, I would sign the Brady Bill for sure. Secondly, I think homeless can be solved. It was a word we never heard before. 10 years ago, the words homeless, crack, and AIDS were not in people's vocabulary. They're there today. The housing investment has to be restored. The mental health, comprehensive mental health has to be made available. And drug treatment for those who need it and can benefit from it has to be provided. Those are the indispensable next steps that are required if we're to get at the total deterioration in our urban civilization.
First of all, I strongly support the Brady Bill. I've been out there on this issue for some time. I also vetoed the so-called anti-local control bill that the National Rifle Association passed in my legislature twice. I think we need to look at some other things, major national efforts at gun buybacks and some other things that we could do once we got the Brady Bill in place. I think homelessness can be solved. I think we need maximum flexibility community by community because, as Governor Brown indicated, there are basically three homeless populations: those who would have been institutionalized, those who have alcohol and drug abuse problems, and those who are simply out of work and down on their luck. And they differ in volume and severity from community to community. So what I would like to see is more funds put out to the cities, and then you shape the homeless initiative according to the dimensions of your population's problems. But I think we can make progress on these problems and on many others.
Let me question now, somebody who's really been in the front lines in the struggle for what's happening in our country, the mayor of Bridgeport, Reverend Jackson and I marched, and here it is, a city that is part of the most wealthiest state in the country, and here we're talking about a city that was practically in bankruptcy. I mean, think about what that means to this country. Mayor Joe Gannon.
Thank you, Mayor Flynn. Mayor Flynn points out that last year, prior to my taking office, Bridgeport became symbolic of the problems confronting America's cities by being the first major municipality to file for municipal bankruptcy. Is this directed to Governor Brown or Governor?
This would be Governor Clinton.
Governor Clinton.
The first question was directed to
you. You're right.
Governor Clinton.
Thank you. Governor Clinton, American cities were dying or being strangled by state and federal mandates. Over the past 10 years, despite the growth by 30% in federal spending, we've seen the dramatic cutback in the funding for federal mandates to states and to local municipalities such as Bridgeport and the other cities. We provide the services for an entire region. We deal with America's homeless, America's poor. We provide the welfare, the hospitals, the social programs, the courthouses, yet we're unable to, at this point, be the recipient of the region's problems any longer. We need a commitment on a federal level for funding for those federal mandates, because we can't shoulder that burden any longer.
As you know, as a governor, I have lived through the mandate nightmare of the 1980s. And I can give you this commitment. First of all, we're going to begin an investment partnership with the cities again. Over the next 5 years, in each successive year, there'll be more and more money to give to the mayors and the cities, as well as the states, to deal with the problems of economic development, of education, of the environment, of health care. Secondly, we're going to give you a system of affordable health care for all. If we can control your health care costs, that will alleviate many of your problems. Thirdly, no mandates without the funding to pay for them. I've been there. I've lived with them. I've seen the education and other budgets of my state and our cities strapped because of these mandates. It is irresponsible in the extreme to keep loading up mandates without the money to pay for them.
Governor Brown, Mayor Flynn spoke eloquently of the fact that the federal government for the last 10 years has turned its back on our common efforts to revive our neighborhoods and to restore a sense of hope. In Syracuse, Governor Clinton personally witnessed the efforts we're making to provide affordable home ownership. He also witnessed the millions we're spending on our schools, in neither case without any help, little help from the federal government. Unfortunately, this morning in a Syracuse newspaper, there was a report made by a task force reporting on the rising instance of aggression in our schools. My question to the two of you is, by way of budget and policy, what kind of investment are you willing to make in the schools of our country? And since both of you have spoken to some extent on this issue earlier, I'd ask you this second part of a question. How would you use your personal leadership skills to turn the attention of the country on the social disintegration as manifested, for example, in the schools in Syracuse? And how would you grab the attention of the Congress, which is so recalcitrant, which you spoke about earlier?
I'd go to these schools, and I'd go to these cities, and I'd show people as best I could what's actually going on. and show the connection between what's happening to their parents or their non-parents, because they don't have a father and mother, or maybe just a single parent. There is this underinvestment. Somebody else talked about that. You have a worse name than that. If this would have been done by an occupying army, you would have called it by its right name. And what is required is to alert and communicate to the American people the truth, the reality, the sense of it. And I believe the natural empathy of the people of this country will respond. They just haven't been asked. And they haven't, I believe, been given the invitation to take back their country in a way that is very simple. It's just investing in our own people, which means we have to make the fundamental choice about what is the level of our commitment abroad in terms of military spending and what is the level of responsibility at home. And when we see the imbalance, we can then make the election a defining event, either to keep neglecting America and our cities and our kids, or to change our whole way on that. And that's really it. We're trying to do too much. We're all over the world as the macho policeman, and we're not in Syracuse, and we're not in Schenectady, and we're not here in New York City. Until we make that real shift, we're going to suffer all the problems we now face. And it isn't about just the list. I agree with that. It's nice to be specific, but we've got to get the moral force at work to get people behind the kind of compassion you're calling for.
Thank you. Governor Clinton.
Mayor, I think we ought to do what we've already said to try to reduce the likelihood of guns being in the hands of our children and people who have access to them. I think we ought to provide more law enforcement funds so that security devices and security personnel can be provided to the schools. I favor early intervention, preschool programs, parent-based programs, smaller classes, elementary counselors. But I don't think this is a simple issue. I think this is a tough issue. The truth is that we have devalued life and disconnected millions and millions of our kids through the disintegration of our society, the most fundamental units, the family, the neighborhood, the church that's not there anymore for many of them. The story in the New York Times indicating that over 9% of our kids are in zero-parent households. I think it is going to be difficult to reconnect these children to our society. There's a interesting article in one of the morning papers today about an anti-violence initiative. I believe that when we do all this, the president still has to use the moral force of the presidency to go to places like Thomas Jefferson High School in Brooklyn and Cardozo in Queens and the Beasley School in Chicago, places I have been, Mayor Perry of Buckley High School in your town of Hartford. We have got to go there, and we've got to say, listen, we want to connect you to your future again. When children understand their relationship to other people and can imagine what they'll be doing 5 or 10 years from now, they do not shoot and stab each other. When their lives are devalued and they think the future is 5 minutes from now and it's just turn a quick buck, get it while you can, they do. And it is not going to be easy. We're going to have to mobilize millions of adults to take personal responsibility for these kids, and it is not going to be easy, but we have to do it.
Thank you, Governor Clinton. We're going to stop for 1 second because of the fact that the mayor of San Juan, Puerto Rico, who could not be with us but did want to raise a question, we have him on the line. Is he here? Mayor Acevedo, how are you? Happy St. Patrick's Day.
Thank you very much. My best regards to both Governor Clinton and Governor Brown. And my question is the following. Taking into consideration that a great number of our Hispanic families live under the poverty level, and in Puerto Rico 62%, and that the unemployment rate is greater in the Hispanic community than in the rest of the population, like in New York, more than 10% of our Hispanic people are unemployed, and that the AIDS virus is infecting poor and minority members of our society in a disproportionate manner, what specific measures will you take as president to enhance the quality of life of our Hispanic families across the nation?
Thank you, Mayor Acevedo. That question goes to Governor Clinton. It's about the employment question.
Employment and AIDS. He also asked about AIDS.
Yes.
And families. First, I think the AIDS problem is not an urban problem. It's also an American problem. I think someone should be put in charge of fighting the war against AIDS. I think the recommendations of the AIDS Commission should be implemented. I think we should do more work on people with AIDS symptoms who are women and IV drug users. We need to increase our investment in that.
and we've got to have a national health program so that the full burden of paying for AIDS does not fall squarely on the shoulders of the cities. It is a national issue. With regard to the economy, Mayor, I can only say what I've said before. We need a developmental strategy, an empowerment strategy for people who live in our cities. Tax incentives, new community development banks, small business incubators, things that will generate jobs. And when we convert from a defense to a domestic economy, we need to give priority and targeted investments to those areas which have lost the most investment so that we can put people back to work.
Governor Brown.
Primarily with AIDS, we need the research. We need the national health care system so that we cover people who are suffering. In terms of jobs again, it's breaking the stranglehold of those who are doing well at everybody else's expense, at the expense of the children, at the expense of the unemployed, at the expense of those who are losing their jobs to foreign cheaper labor markets. And I stress not just a list of programs, but a shift in power. That's why I emphasize the repeal of 14B, labor law reform, and the wide expansion of employee stock ownership. When people have a share of management, they will take greater responsibility. They will ensure that communities are protected, equipment is modernized, and we get the kind of more balanced, equitable distribution of wealth and income that this society is seen as a disappearing and faint memory. So it's giving people the power, but doing it by putting tools in their hands so they can shift the investment strategies of this nation.
Thank you very much, Mayor. Thank you. Next question, the Mayor of Jersey City, Marilyn Roman.
Thank you. Governor Clinton. Is that to Governor Clinton?
It goes to Governor Brown.
Okay. A number of years ago, the Korean government set aside a five-year plan which brought their nation from an agrarian to a manufacturing society. They now have a new five-year plan because for those of us who go into the department stores of America, we know that their manufacturing plan has worked. They now have a new five-year plan that goes from manufacturing to high technology. Obviously, their government took a great deal of put a great deal of emphasis on this and took great part in that. But even in countries like Germany and Scandinavia, the transition to work programs closely associate business and the schools with a large part of the assistance coming from the government. On the federal level, some suggestions have been proposed to emulate that system to some degree. How do you plan to bring those entities together, and how will you make business responsible for such participation?
Governor Brown.
We need some national objectives. We've had a president that said we'll put a man on the moon in 10 years. We'll build a nuclear bomb. We'll build an interstate highway system. Build a space shuttle. We'll win a war in the Gulf. There have been national goals that then stimulate investment and human activity. What is lacking are those goals that will stimulate achieving what's needed now, and that is an elegant, efficient society, one that's environmentally sustainable, and one that is equitable and fair to all the citizens. It's just a matter of the president setting forth the goal and then people pulling together to take the means to make it happen. To date, we don't even have the goal in mind. We're still fighting foreign fears and foreign threats while the domestic challenge of inequality and institutional neglect and all the degradation that we're submitting millions of Americans to is just neglected and passed over. So what is missing here is the national leadership and the national goal. Once we set that, we can pull the manufacturing and labor and schools all together, and we can make America work. There's hundreds, thousands of examples of people in local communities and businesses making things happen. We haven't tapped into the creativity and the innovative capacity of this nation, not even by a small shot.
Thank you. Governor Clinton.
I think it's important to recognize that we are very much out of step in this. Every other nation, not only the ones you mentioned, the ones you didn't, every nation that's a rich country or striving to become a rich country has a national economic strategy in which the national leader takes the lead, and there is partnership between business, labor, education, and the government working together. Every other nation, only the United States believes the role of the president is to keep taxes low on corporations and very wealthy people, keep inflation low, and get out of the way. We have gone from first to tenth in wages. The work week has lengthened. We've lost our economic leadership. Our society is disintegrating. Of course, we have to do what they do. And we can learn from them. A national health policy that incorporates the best elements of other countries. A labor market policy. The Scandinavians are best at that. Organizing exports. The Germans are best at that. Investing in research and development and turning those into manufacturing jobs. The Japanese are best at that. The Taiwanese, with 20 million people, less than one-tenth of the American population, are going to invest $300 billion in the next 5 years. They're going to eat our lunch unless we do the same. This is not even about Republicans and Democrats. It's about the 80s versus the 90s and whether we're going to compete in the world that we've done so much to make.
Thank you, gentlemen. Does anybody need a rebuttal on that, or should we move into the next question? Why don't we move to Mayor Cooper of East Orange, New Jersey.
Thank you very much, Mayor Flynn. And let me say that as we talk about the problems facing America's cities, the question that comes to mind is whether we have the will to do what's right. That's what it comes down to. Every question has been posed today simply can be dealt with if we have the will and the desire to do it. And when we talk about how we solve problems in America, the first thing we have to do is figure out how we created the problems in America. Healthcare, and every candidate has talked, has said they believe in a universal healthcare reform system. Healthcare in this country is extremely costly, and people simply can't afford it. But interestingly enough, as we look at the availability, increasing need for healthcare in this country, we recognize that we have not dealt with primary and prevention care, and it's costing us a ton of money in order to solve problems was created as a result of lack of interest or lack of input by people in our White House, and I'll leave it at that. Including the current administration. But when we look at the cost to the nation and the cost to urban cities and also rural cities of what it costs for us to treat people once the illness is set in, be it infant mortality rates increasing because we're not taking care of our children properly, elderly can't afford health care services and the type of problems they have, and the issue of AIDS and drug abuse itself rolls right into this question, how do we best handle our problems in urban cities when we cannot afford to put the type of preventive care measures that we need for our people? So I would ask this question, how do we get primary care facilities and doctors to invest and work in America's cities, providing preventive and primary health care for our people? What type of policies would you initiate in this country to affect urban cities in that particular vein?
First of all, to those who say that we cannot afford this, let me point out we're spending 30% more than any other country on earth. And yet a child born in Shanghai, China, has a better chance of living to be 1 year old or 75 years old than a child born in New York, for the simple reason that we don't provide primary and preventive care. How would we do it? No matter how you design a national health system with coverage for everybody, you have to provide health facilities in inner city areas and isolated rural areas. You have to dramatically expand the National Health Service Corps so that you have doctors and other health professionals, and they have to be able to go into clinics in the inner city. In Harlem, two public health clinics have been closed in the last year or so because the area was not qualified to receive Health Service Corps doctors because the money wasn't there. What's going to happen? We're going to spend a lot more money, except it'll be spent on the back end by people who flood emergency rooms. So under any conceivable national health system, a few billion dollars must be set aside for public health clinics in inner city neighborhoods and rural areas, and I would argue in the public schools of this country, to protect our children against AIDS, teen pregnancy, and other dreaded problems.
Governor Brown.
The problems you mentioned are the very reason why I support a unified national health system, one with a single payer, universal health care. Medical care is a right, not a commodity. That will then allow for the proper adjustment of the balance between specialization and primary care. There will be a single payer, so the negotiation will have the clout of one purchaser of medical services. That's how you get primary care in the urban and in the rural areas, by providing the proper incentives and balancing it by reducing the excessive specialization that is costing unnecessary billions of dollars. Secondly, I'd point out that many of the medical ills are the result of social pathology. Drug overdoses, gunshots, knives, fights, gang warfare, and all the rest of it. So underneath these medical costs, you find a lot of social pathology that has to be part of your larger program. And finally, the effect of occupational health hazards. Working people are dying at the rate of 10 a day. Injuries are like 1,000 a day. And that has to be addressed too, and that's why I say it has to be part of a comprehensive national health care service that all people are implicated in, and therefore we avoid the 2 and 3 and 4 tiers of quality of care.
Thank you,
Doug. Can I have a rebuttal?
Yeah.
I mean, just rejoinder?
Sure.
I just want to be explicit about this. When Senator Kerry was in this race and was in favor of a national health single-payer system, as Governor Brown has recommended, he recognized that even with a single-payer system in a country like ours where 15% of the docs are general practitioners as opposed to over 50 in Canada, you had to have a separate budget item set aside for clinics in urban areas and in rural areas. I would add to that schools, and you have to have more National Health Service Corps doctors because the delivery system is simply not out there now. We have to create that, and I think that is very important. I agree with Governor Brown about the social pathology. That's why in my health care program, we also provide funds for more vigorous education programs and prevention programs in the workplace and in the schools. You have to do those things to save the money you need to pay for the rest of the system.
This is an incredibly important issue, and I just want to add one point for the record here. However, what I see is the critical issue. Are we going to stand up to the doctors, and are we going to stand up to the insurance companies? Because those are the people who are really ripping off the system. We got 33 billion people who are uninsured. Is the money going to come from more tax dollars, or is it going to come when our president and our Congress stands up to the doctors and the insurance companies? I think that's the issue.
Who goes first?
Governor Brown, do you want to answer that question?
You have to ration greed and not need. And the fact is that $30 billion goes into the congressional campaigns every 2 years to keep it the way it is. And this, like everything else, requires a mobilization of offsetting political force to move into something new and better and more equal. And that can only happen if we have a very different kind of politics, because the way it is didn't get here by accident. It's been built up by a very systematic undermining of democratic participation.
Let me just say, I spent a lot of time in the last year as co-chair of a governor's group on this health care issue, and I've talked to thousands of people about this. We should not start with a tax increase. You should take on these insurance companies. Only 84 cents on the dollar in America goes into health care, 95 cents in Europe, almost 99 in Canada.
That's right.
The German system controls costs better than any on earth because they do things like restrain drug companies from increasing prices at 3 times the rate of inflation. You've got American drug companies charging more for drugs made in America here than overseas. You've got the doctor problem is more complicated because 30% of the average doctor's income goes to paperwork because of the incredible proliferation of 1,500 health insurance companies, thousands of policies, all the government rules and regulations. If you cleaned out the insurance inefficiencies, controlled the oligopolistic prices of the drug companies, and dramatically reduced paperwork, you could easily get the money you need to pay for this system and bring it in line with inflation. But you got to start by taking on the interest groups, and that's why you're having an election, where people can make these commitments and Congress can see they've been made and follow through on them.
Thank you, Governor.
I just add a slight note to that. If you're going to take away all the power of the drug companies to set prices like every other business, and you're going to curb the ability of the insurance companies to write different kind of policies, then why not just get the insurance companies out of the way and have a direct single payer and not have this intermediary middleman absorbing the $40, $50 billion that it does?
Mayor of Albany, New York, Tom Whalen. Question we directed, the last question directed to Governor Brown.
Governor, nothing seems to be getting further and further away from the average American than fulfilling his dream of owning one's own home. We've had one housing bill come out of Washington in 12 years. We mayors think that's a national disgrace. What initiatives would you undertake to ensure that America's housing stock was restored?
The number one thing I would do would be to simplify the tax code, shift the spending from defense by the 50% figure that I've used over 5 years for the reinvestment in the domestic sector, which is going to create hundreds of thousands, if not millions of jobs, commit this country to the elimination of 50% of the energy consumption we now have, create the millions of jobs that will generate the income that will allow for the purchase of housing, and more directly, to provide assistance to first-time homeowners by some direct government assistance program where that is appropriate to the extent the private market can't make that work.
I would specifically provide a first-time homebuyer tax credit. I would increase the guarantee from 65% upward on FHA houses. I would provide a permanent low-income housing credit and historic preservation credit, as well as some other incentives to invest in our cities. I would do it along the lines that would encourage more local partnerships, like the Nehemiah partnerships, where you have the bankers kicking in, the developers kicking in. And finally, I would give incentives for energy efficiency in the homes. I was in a Hispanic neighborhood in Chicago where with concrete construction, with the walls built on the outside of the concrete, they cut the energy bills by one-fourth and the fire insurance rates by nine-tenths. I mean, the energy bills by three-fourths, fire insurance rates by nine-tenths. I think you need a systematic program that leverages limited federal dollars with private dollars and local dollars to deal with this. And also, you've got to increase direct federal housing investment. Home ownership is now less frequent among younger workers than it than has been in the last 20, 30 years. And it takes more than 10 times as long just to work to pay the closing cost than it did 30 years ago.
Thank you, Governor Clinton. Mayor Dinkins, do we want to wrap it up here,
please? Yes, we do. The first closing statement comes from Governor Brown. When they have concluded, we would request that the media and others permit the candidates to leave. They need a few minutes to themselves so that they can prepare for a debate this evening at 7.
7, right.
And you may have a desire to put questions to some of the mayors here assembled. So first, Governor Brown, 2 minutes.
Okay, the basis of our whole campaign here is there's something profoundly off balance in the American political system as it is now functioning. You've just heard an hour and a half of people giving very reasonable proposals and suggestions, answers and questions to the greatest threat to our society, namely the destruction of urban civilization. And yet, for some reason, nothing's being done about it. I contend that the gap here is not the failure to micromanage with lists, either by the Congress or the governors or the mayors, but a failure of the system itself to galvanize the political will for change. Half the people aren't voting because they're not given a choice. They're not given a choice because the system is rigged by those who have insulated themselves from all the ills that have been described. We the People is a coalition effort of trade unionists, rainbow coalition people, environmentalists, students, hospital workers, mayors, and anyone else we can find who want to join together to change the very center of gravity of contemporary politics. The whole matter of limiting contributions to $100, using the 800 number, and all the rest of it is to create the possibility for a grassroots revolution at taking back of what really belongs to us. Thomas Jefferson said 201 years ago in this very state that the goal of the Democratic Party was to stop the power of the few from rioting on the labors of the many. And we've heard today various ways in which the few have been rioting on the labors of the many. What I commit myself to is to join with mayors who propose 7-point programs that are wonderful ways of revitalizing the cities, that take no more money than the Congress voted last week to bail out the SNL mess, but it never gets done because the people don't believe there's any way we can move aside the corrupt status quo. That's the reason why I keep coming back to the invitation to those who don't believe, join us. Join together in a campaign you control, and together, not me and not Clinton, but we the people taking it back to do the very things we discussed by moving aside those who are in charge.
Thank you very much. Governor Clinton.
I think this country is suffering from economic decline.
grievous disintegration of our most fundamental societal institutions, leaving millions of our children bereft, subject to violence and neglect, and a future less than their parents. The cause of it is political neglect from which the American people have voted in voting for divided government and simple ideas that sound great and make things worse. The truth is that the problems of our cities are the problems of all Americans. They just occur in greater numbers and with greater intensity in the cities. We need a fundamental change in this election that goes beyond what the Democrats and the Republicans have done in Washington for 10 years, that recognizes this is a race of the 80s against the 90s, of whether we're going to put our people first, restore the middle class, reduce poverty, and do it by doing what we know works, having a national strategy to develop the economy, a national education strategy, a national health care strategy, a national investment strategy, a national strategy to convert from a defense to a domestic economy, a national strategy, by having a national movement toward creating more opportunity, but insisting on more responsibility from all of our people to solve these terrible social problems that we have. Nothing has been done because the people did not vote for a president who would take responsibility for the American people and their problems. That is what you have elections for. And I would say that I've worked through the 80s to make these changes. I know what the mayors mean when they talk about mandates and neglect and being asked to do more with less. I have been there. I understand this, and I know how to turn it around. Yes, in the last 10 years, the power of the few has been used to ride on the labors of the many. 1% of the people have gotten 60% of the economic growth. But the answer is not a simple idea like the flat tax plus the 13% national value-added tax. It is an assault on the very idea that the president does not have responsibility to assume the direction of a national economic strategy. That's what I pledge, and together we can make this country what it ought to be.
I have just one added question for these two distinguished candidates. We are privileged to have in our audience former Deputy Mayor Osborne Elliott, who proposed to the U.S. Conference of Mayors at Hyannis that there be a march on Washington. And Ray Flynn and I and the mayors there gathered seized this notion, and we are marching on Washington on May 16th. So the question, gentlemen, will you join us?
Yes.
Yes.
Delighted. Thank you all very much.
What did we just commit to now? Is that the day of the California primary?
No.
No.
June 2nd.
We'll be there.
Listen, thank
Thanks.
You very much.
Thank you.
And I want to thank you all for adhering to our rules.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you very much.
Well done, buddy.
Good.
Okay. Okay. Thanks.
Somebody help the governor get out this way.
A victory, man. That's what we need around. Victory for the people.
And the violence leads to the president's voice pointing at peace.
That concludes this Democratic presidential candidates debate from Gracie Mansion in New York between Governor Bill Clinton and Jerry Brown. Voters in New York State go to the polls next Tuesday. And, of course, you can follow the candidates on the campaign trail by tuning to Journalist Roundtable every Friday morning beginning at 8 o'clock Eastern Time, 2 p.m. Pacific Time, here on C-SPAN. And there's Road to the White House, Friday afternoons beginning at 5 Eastern Time, 2 Pacific.
I don't know what they're doing now. No, let the governors go.
These are some of the people assisting former California Governor Jerry Brown with his campaign for the presidency. The campaign manager is Jody Evans. She was manager and treasurer of his unsuccessful 1982 Senate race. Ms. Evans also ran Jerry Brown's Los Angeles office during the 1980 presidential race. She was state finance chairwoman of his campaign to be reelected governor of California in 1978. Ms. Evans works at the Santa Monica, California campaign headquarters. The national press secretary is freelance writer Alana Wachtel. She is based at the Alexandria, Virginia campaign office. Joe Costello is the national communications director, and he is posted at the Santa Monica office. He worked on the presidential campaigns of Democrats Jesse Jackson in 1988 and Senator Edward Kennedy in 1980. Mr. Costello left his job as San Diego program director for the consumer group Citizen Action. The campaign's research director is Ben Rabinowitz. He worked on the 1988 presidential bids by Gary Hart and Senator Albert Gore Jr. Mr. Rabinowitz also was involved in Jerry Brown's 1982 Senate race and his 1980 presidential campaign. Patrick Cadell is Jerry Brown's primary campaign advisor. Mr. Cadell was a political strategist with Jimmy Carter's successful presidential campaign in 1976. He is an unpaid advisor to former Governor Brown. Jacques Berzaghi is a longtime friend and aide of Jerry Brown. He travels with Mr. Brown and has worked in a variety of positions for the former governor during the past 20 years. The pollsters for the Brown campaign are Alex Evans and Don McDonough. The Brown campaign does its media work in-house. National campaign headquarters of the Brown campaign is located in Santa Monica, California. Here is a look at some of the people managing Governor Bill Clinton's bid for the presidency. His campaign manager is David Wilhelm. He is president of the Strategy Group, a public affairs consulting firm in Chicago. Mr. Wilhelm served as campaign manager for Chicago Mayor Richard M. Daley in 1989 and in 1991. He also ran Senator Paul Simon's successful 1984 campaign. Bruce Lindsay is the campaign director for Governor Clinton. He is a partner with the law firm of Wright, Lindsay, and Jennings, located in Little Rock, Arkansas. From 1979 through 1981, he worked as legislative director for Arkansas Senator David Pryor. Serving as deputy campaign manager for the Clinton campaign is George Stephanopoulos. He is on leave from his job as executive floor assistant to House Majority Leader Richard Gephardt. Dee Dee Myers serves as press secretary. She previously worked on San Francisco Mayor Frank Jordan's campaign. Ms. Myers has also been involved in former Mayor Dianne Feinstein's campaigns, and 4 years ago, she worked on Michael Dukakis' presidential bid. Governor Clinton has two finance directors. Rahm Emanuel is a partner with the Research Group, a Chicago campaign research firm. And Amy Zazouk is a partner with a Chicago fundraising and consulting business. James Carville is Governor Clinton's chief strategist. Mr. Carville most recently served as strategist for Pennsylvania Senator Harris Wofford's successful campaign against former Attorney General Dick Thornburgh. Washington poll taker Stanley Greenberg is tracking public opinion for the Clinton campaign. The media consultant is Frank Greer. Mr. Greer has provided media advice for several successful Senate and gubernatorial races, including Douglas Wilder's 1990 campaign for governor of Virginia. The Clinton presidential campaign headquarters is located in Little Rock, Arkansas.
C-SPAN, the cable satellite public affairs network, and its companion network, C-SPAN 2, are privately funded to serve the public by America's cable television companies.
Now here is a look at today's programming, and please note that all listed times are Eastern. Next, a pair of news conferences on the House bank investigation. You will hear from the Republican Campaign Committee Chairman and then the Democratic Campaign Committee Chairman. First, it's the comments of Guy Vanderjack, Republican from Michigan, and then remarks by California Democrat Vic Fazio. At 6:40 this morning, Massachusetts Congressman Joseph Early holds a briefing on the House investigative panel's release of the names of 22 members who it says were the most frequent abusers of the House bank. Congressman Early found himself on that list. Then it's News One, the evening newscast from Moscow.
Next, we take you to Capitol Hill for coverage of a news conference held Thursday by Congressman Guy Vanderjack, Republican from Michigan. The 13-term lawmaker, who is chairman of the Republican Campaign Committee, spoke with reporters about the House bank investigation and Wednesday night's release of the names of the 22 worst offenders of house banking privileges.
Well, thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being here. I apologize for being just a few minutes late. I think the statement speaks for itself. It does remind me of...
You have a statement. You want to tell us what it is? This is what we distributed last
week. I'll tell you what it is, and you can pick it up on the way out. I won't take over 2 minutes telling you what it is, and then we'll go right to your questions. The statement reminds me of what Winston Churchill said during World War II, and I think it applies to the Democrat bank scandal and the information that was released last night.